So I'm joined here today for this episode of The Vote by Bradley Dearman. Welcome back to Latest TV and The Vote. So,
thank you for having me again.
Yeah. First of all, just let us know a bit about what you do. You hypnotise people, basically, don't you? And you deal with kind of people's emotions, people's mental health issues. So maybe you're the better one to explain.
Yeah, I wouldn't say I hypnotise anyone. The reality is we can only go into that relaxed state on our own, you know, of our own will.
Yeah.
So I don't get anyone to cluck like a chicken or, you know, pretend they're a rabbit. I'm a hypnotherapist, but I also use psychotherapy in what I do. The hypnotherapy is about once we've had an open discussion to try and look at the key issues that person's experiencing, then we get them into a relaxed state to look a little bit deeper to help them resolve that. So, but yeah, I'm a practitioner in Brighton. I also run a teaching school in Brighton.
Yeah.
For one of, you know, people that want to be a practitioner themselves. I also run workshops because one of the things I noticed, particularly in Brighton, that there's such a great demand for people seeking, you know, good mental health that I started workshops that, whilst I've identified them initially as a key issue of anxiety, that opens up to a far bigger subject. But it's about educating them and giving them the opportunity to look a bit further out, what can they do for themselves.
Yeah, and you're finding your workload's increasing in Brighton, aren't you? So there's a lot of mental health issues that are unaddressed in Brighton, which is might surprise some people, might not surprise people, but it's definitely an issue, isn't it?
Yeah, there was a significant upturn post-Brexit, post the vote, and I think media has reported, you know, that's across the board nationally. But somewhere like Brighton will feel the force probably a little bit more than somewhere else because we're such a diverse community. We're a very accepting and liberal community. So when we see something that's causing conflict, the sort of empaths in us kind of sort of start to come out, and we feel that, you know, we don't necessarily engage directly and say this is down to the EU, I feel this way, but it can increase our levels of anxiety, our levels of stress.
Yeah, so for many people, kind of political issues, they're triggers, really, aren't they, for other issues that they might have, is that right? Because it is a highly emotive issue, isn't it? And it's I'm really surprised by some of my friends, how they feel really strongly about it, which is a good, you know, good thing that they feel they get let. It's like an outlet, but it's really, you never thought that they would actually feel that strongly about something.
Yeah, there's a really strong engagement with it.
Yeah.
You know, there's social media, for example, people are really engaged and interested no matter what side or what their political stance is. It really is, it's strong and it really is affecting people and how they feel. And of course, there's a lot of uncertainty out there. The need has grown, you know, significantly. And, you know, it is a really changing sort of place, politics, right now, isn't it?
So what particular issues are coming up, when you... in your consultation rooms in Brighton, what are the issues that people are dealing with?
I think initially there was a lot of anxiety and a lot of anger. Obviously, a lot of people were angry about the result, the way the way it came about, you know, or how they believe it came about, you know, the political language that was used to get that. But a lot of anxiety because, of course, a lot of people, particularly in a diverse community, are actually concerned about, you know, their well-being. You know, is it going to affect a whole manner of things from their living status, their healthcare, their, you know, pensions, you know, just their living status in the UK if they're an EU migrant as such. So
people are actually seeking therapy, counselling, as a result, on the back of that result?
Yeah.
For that specifically, so that's kind of the starting point.
Yeah, and what was really interesting, because there's so much being reported on by national papers, there's so much research out there, you know, the BACP are putting reports out about how they see mental health being affected by politics. Actually, as a therapist, when you look at the changes between the vote itself to where we are now, you can actually really see a change in the demographic of people that are coming to see you.
Yeah, and I think the key thing with the current political environment is it's uncertain, and a lot of people, particularly you've got kind of mental health issues, uncertainty is one of the great devil, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
It's the one thing that can trigger lots of other things, right?
Yeah, well, a report, I think it was in June, come out that says about 72% of the population fear that actually the divide and what's going on could actually get worse.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of people are in actual real dismay about the situation.
Yeah. So how can people deal with those feelings then, people that are listening? You know, how can they sit better with that feeling of uncertainty, you know? Because it's, unfortunately, it's not going to get any better anytime soon, is it, by the looks of it? So how can they better sit with those uncomfortable feelings and kind of process them?
Yeah, well of course, what's going on in the political sense isn't the be-all and end-all, and that isn't necessarily the root cause of the extent of the feeling that someone has. So actually reaching out, either whether it's through starting to talk to people, whether that's, you know, in their social group, whether that's reaching out for professional help, and starting to, you know, really look at themselves and why it's affecting them so much, because it will just be increasing the level of anxiety, the level of fear, or the level of anger you feel. But by dealing with that, you can then be more objective in how you see things going forward, and you can take a little bit more charge of your own destiny rather than being so reliant on a vote, for example.
Yeah, so are there any practical things that people can do at home, you know, before they seek
Yeah, definitely. One of the key things will be is to educate yourself. You know, what is the reality or potential reality of the outcome? You know, and what can you do objectively for yourself so that if what happens doesn't necessarily go your way, you are still more able to take charge of your destiny. So educating yourself is the first thing, and really look into what it all means for you, you know, in your individual circumstance.
Yeah. And what about, like, thinking about the worst case scenario? I was talking to a previous guest earlier this morning, and you know, the way they deal with things, with cognitive behaviour therapy, is that they kind of think, well, what's the worst thing can happen? And once you can deal with the worst thing that can happen, then you can better kind of prepare for it, and you're kind of ready. Is that a good
basically,
way of thinking?
Basically, obviously when our levels of stress and anxiety are increased by uncertainty, the thing is we do fear the worst. And actually, even sometimes when we look at the worst fear, actually it's something we can overcome.
Yeah. Because I've spoken to some, particularly social worker friends, and they saying that, you know, because that might mean you have a fear, and where's that fear come from? But so is it a good thing or bad thing to think about the worst case scenario, because I know a lot of people that do it. Is that a good thing?
Well, it's
or does it depend, or is it more grey area?
Yeah, if you look at facing what your worst fear is, that you either can, at that point, before it happens, before your worst fear is going to actually happen, you can either, one, work out, can I deal with it? Can I engage with it? Can I overcome it? Or two, do I need help? And look at what resources are available to you. So actually thinking about your worst fear is quite a positive thing, because it can be something you use to educate yourself, to work out what's going on for you, to seek professional help, to take action. So
Most people in everyday life, you don't really think about kind of deeper feelings, do you? That's a bit of an issue, isn't it? Particularly in Western society, maybe not elsewhere in the world, where they kind of they're more contemplative, but we're not. Don't think like that, do we?
No, and a lot starts when we're very young. It's kind of, we're not educated how to use our mind, are we?
When you
go to school, we have lessons about all manner of subjects, but we're not educated how to use our mind.
Whereas in France, for example, they learn about philosophy at quite a young age. So,
yeah.
Whereas we don't.
Yeah, learning things. learning about how our mind works, you know, not necessarily, you know, divulging into deep psychology, but learning about, you know, mental health, you know, what it means. Maybe even, you know, for example, doing in schools, looking at doing yoga and mindfulness and meditation rather than just sports, you know, or, you know, engaging in activities that don't necessarily suit everybody anyway. So there are opportunities to learn a little bit more about yourself and actually take on board the importance of mental health.
Yeah. So we can talk about this in the second half, but just briefly, what are the key steps that people can take themselves to get better mental health? And again, this is something we can talk about in the second half as well.
Yeah. Research, what it is you're looking for. taking time to consider what it is you're looking to achieve from it. You know,
yeah.
Is there a particular symptom? Is there a particular subject that's causing you conflict? You know, but yeah, reach out, start talking to people, maybe talking to friends and family. Has someone else had success, you know,
yeah.
with a certain type of therapy? Sometimes it can be going to yoga or like a meditation class, just
yeah.
starting that journey. Sometimes picking up the phone, because most therapists like myself would do a free consultation.
Yeah.
So pick up the phone and talk to people.
Okay, we'll leave that there for now. So join us for the second half. We're going to be talking a lot more about the work that Bradley does and in his consultation rooms, but also just about mental health and hypnotherapy in general. So welcome back to The Vote. I'm here with Bradley, and we're talking about your work as a hypnotherapist. Got that out. So what anxiety is a big issue, isn't it, in Brighton that you're presented with? Why do you think Brighton's kind of a place where people kind of present to you with anxiety issues? Because for me, it's quite a precarious lifestyle. There's quite a relatively low-wage economy. These are all factors which make up... the issues that people come with to you. Is that right?
Yeah, it's a mixture of factors. Firstly, we're a very diverse community, so there's something, you know, about Brighton that attracts people, and that is the sort of the acceptance, the ability to come here and be themselves more than probably anywhere in the UK. So.
Yeah.
But usually there's a reason why someone is searching for somewhere like Brighton, you know, a place to sort of explore themselves and be themselves. So a lot can be down to their upbringing, so they've come here to get away from that. But of course, the difficult years, if we've had an underlying anxiety or depression, when we go to a place, it doesn't just sort of magically disappear. Real life can then start to re-trigger that, whether it's, you know, politics, as we spoke about before, or whether it's, like you say, the cost of living, you know.
Yeah.
Brighton is a very high-cost place to live, so, you know, that comes with its pitfalls as a human being, doesn't it?
Yeah, because people come here to kind of get away with things, but then they find out they want to be contemplative, but then they're kind of dealing with everyday issues, you know, putting bread on the table, paying their rent, and that doesn't... Because you need time and space to kind of... be contemplative. That is a big issue, isn't it? Because you kind of need to set aside time and for your own mental well-being, don't you?
Yeah. And sometimes it comes at a cost, you know.
Yeah.
If you want to do a yoga class, for example, and you're living on the breadline, it's not so simple. So
exactly.
In Brighton, you will see more people going out into the parks or, you know, doing stuff for themselves. But, of course, as a human being, one of our innate qualities is that we want to thrive, we want to prosper, we want to fulfil a purpose, you know. So we want to feel valued, you know, and that can be in our job. It can actually be taking, you know, financial remuneration to feel valued, but that's very hard to do when, you know, you're on a low wage or 0-hour contract, particularly when the cost of living's so high.
Yeah. What's the root cause of anxiety? Is it always traced back to childhood anxiety, or can you kind of develop anxiety issues, for example, in the workplace, if you've got a particularly difficult workplace and it just builds up over a number of years?
Yeah, it's a mixture of things. Research will show that the majority would have been through our childhood years, because then we're starting to experience... you know, when we feel a little bit more vulnerable, you know, than we will as an adult. You know, as an adult, you can be more objective and you're more in charge of your circumstances. But yes, you know, living, the cost of living, you know, your job, your employer, you know, the place you live in and the community around you has an effect on that. Anxiety itself is what we would term as a presenting symptom.
Yeah.
So it's almost a defence mechanism that we use. It's a warning, you know, it's an early alarm, you know, signal. But, of course, when we're left in situations, so if you take you know, people in a low socioeconomic situation, for example, when you're faced with those day-to-day struggles,
yes.
then your whatever symptoms you experience are there day-to-day. You know,
yeah.
So it's not like you're going to switch it on and off. You're going to be engaging with that emotion every day.
Yeah, because you could potentially have anxiety issues, but they don't actually come out and manifest themselves because you kind of have quite a middle-class life, and so you could go through life and it doesn't actually manifest itself. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean, a lot
but
of people...
But then it might do right at the end of your... You know, for example, if you've got terminal illness, then it might...
I've worked with a lot with people that haven't necessarily noticed how emotions are affecting them until yeah. they retire. You know, they've had a purpose in life, for example, where they've maybe had a high-powered job or very yeah. what they see as an important job that's defining them, and then of course when they retire, they can actually really lose their sense of themselves.
Yes.
You know, and even doing the simplest thing on a day-to-day basis, you know. Doing housework or doing tidy up, things that we would all take for granted can actually yeah. seem really, you know, difficult for them. So it can manifest itself at any time. You know, in general, if we are aware of what sets off our anxiety, then obviously we can either be objective about how we engage with it, or we can go, do I need to be in that environment?
You know? Yeah, yeah. Because sometimes anxiety can be a protective thing and you don't necessarily suffer from anxiety, but just in certain situations you're a bit anxious. I'm thinking, you know, if you're walking alone at night and there's a gang of people chasing after you, you're anxious.
Yeah,
that's
well,
a good thing, isn't it?
Because
it'd be a bit weird if you weren't anxious, right? So it's kind of knowing what's...
Well, it's sort of, you know, almost publicly it's all thought of as a negative thing, but it is something there
yes.
to instinctively yeah. keep us alive, you know.
Exactly,
so
yeah.
It is really important to have anxiety, and it is important to listen yeah. to it. Why do I feel anxious about this situation?
Yeah.
What is it? Is it rational?
Yeah.
Or is it an irrational thing that I need to take away and think about, you know, and think about, you know, working out and getting over? But yeah, so for example, your average person will think about going to an interview or going and doing a public speech or something like that. You know, oh yeah, but everybody gets anxious doing that. Well, not necessarily, but we would normally have a heightened level of anxiety
yeah,
in that situation.
Which is normal and that's natural.
Yeah, it means it's important to you.
Yeah.
And that's the first thing to think. When you feel anxious, something is really important to you.
So yeah.
Think about what is its importance.
So when does it? So when it gets kind of more of a mental health issue, then it's when it's a repetitive.
Yeah, I mean
cycle.
Yeah. So some people will feel anxiety every day, and when I talk to clients, sometimes they will say, you know, we try and use almost like a barometer. So when they come in to identify, and some will say, well, actually, you know, I'm feeling, I don't know, anxiety level 6 or 7. You know, 10 would be the worst. You know, would be a panic attack. But I'd like to feel lower. I'd like to feel a 5 or 4 or 3, some 0. But it's not until they really think about it, they could have been living with anxiety every day as far as they could remember, but it's on a lower scale.
Yeah.
That lower scale kind of is their way of... they don't want to take the risk of feeling no anxiety. They don't want to take the risk that they can go from 0 to 10 sort of thing. So
yeah. I'm just thinking, is there a lot we can learn from sports people? Because obviously they... You know, particularly footballers, Premier League. You know, those kind of high performance athletes. How do they deal with stuff? Because I always think there's a lot we can learn from. You know, some sports people here, particularly the elite athletes.
I'm not sure, but one of the misconceptions is that we work well under pressure. You know, that a lot of people have that perception.
Yeah.
But actually, is that true? I think what's happened a lot more in sports and in sports psychology is they're actually getting people to a calmer state. You know, trying to, before you engage in your athletics or your football, try and relax first. You know, don't feel this high, because anxiety can be exhausting.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so just before we finish up then, so how can people reach out to you and, you know, what kind of issues can you deal with and you know, the work that you're doing? Because I know you're doing workshops as well, so we'll talk a bit more about your work.
Yeah, my website is bdhypnotherapy.com.
Yeah.
Or, you know, look me up on social media. I'm on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. You know, I've modernised like everybody else. But in terms of what people come in for, it's literally anything. Anything that you think is affecting you in your life. You know,
yeah.
People don't always pick up the phone and say, I have anxiety or depression. They might be sort of lost in who they are. They might feel they're struggling with weight or health. It can be anything. You know, just pick up the phone and have that conversation.
Yeah. And what do you offer then? So you'll look into that issue. And I guess you're independent because you often don't know these people. That's quite important, isn't it? That someone's, it's not, because you can talk to your friends, but they kind of know you quite well. So they might talk to you in a way that, you know, you're tolerant of, whereas you're kind of more objective. Is that right?
Yeah, it is about being objective. And it's about giving that person the space where they feel confident that they can tell you anything. And that you are there for them, and that's the key thing is having a relationship where they know that you are there for them, that you know you've got their back, you're looking out for their well-being, and they are a priority to you when they walk in that door.
Yeah, and just lastly, the workshops that you're running, what are they about?
There's two types of workshop I run. Yeah. The first one is anxiety biased, but like I said, anxiety. Because of that, that is a symptom behind that. We look at actually how to look for the root causes to reduce your anxiety, not just treating it as a symptom. If you treat it as a symptom, the root cause will still be there, so it will come out in another way. So I run anxiety courses, you know, and a lot of that is about promoting self-help, and also an introduction to hypnotherapy. So people get a greater understanding of how to use hypnotherapy in a positive way for themselves and even with their family.
Perfect. All right, thanks for coming in today, Bradley. All the best. We'll catch up again soon, no doubt.
Take care.
And speak to you soon.
Thank
Cheers.
You very much.
Thanks.